born in 1937 in Littlefield, Texas. Music's always been big in West Texas. It's either music or full of cotton. All you got to do is spend one day in a cotton patch, and you'll know that there's got to be a better world out there somewhere. When I was about 12, I entered a lot of talent contests, and I finally got my own 15-minute radio show. I guess that was the scariest I've ever been in my whole life. But I made it. And I really never lost sight of what I wanted to be. You know, when you're born in Texas, you're taught that you're a little bit bigger, a little better, a little bit smarter, and a whole lot tougher than anybody else. Now, the really tough part is when you get out in the world and you find out you ain't.
Till next Thursday night from 5 after 8 till 8:30. This is Waylon Jennings, saying we'll see you then.
Those are some of the best times of my life was when I was at KLL. It was really a free for all because we had a lot of personalities on the air. Most of us were pretty funny.
We were in a lot of trouble there. They used to have these big old, E.T. things that the Navy Department would send out. The Navy recruiting, Johnny Appleseed, that's what it was. And Farron Young presents the Navy, and it rolled, it's about this big around. You roll them up on the turntable, flop them over, and then Waylon and I'd go bowling.
The local pickers, you know, we were about 16, 17 years old at the time. We'd go up there and hang out. I suppose we were in the way, but they never made us feel that way, you know.
And Sonny Curtis and Buddy Holly, and they'd all come up there, and we'd write songs, and or they'd write songs, sit there in the control room, play them, record demos back then.
Anyway, we started the first jingle that they use, you know, we use those to, for advertising, and the first station IDs.
My buddy decided he wanted to start a record label, and Waylon was the first artist he signed. He brought Waylon over and cut some sides with him.
It was a real fun evening. We hanging out, and Waylon was recording, and you know, everybody had great expectations.
Buddy had flown in a sax player by the name of King Curtis to play on Waylon's. And as I recall, it seems like we cut a couple of things for the Crickets and used King Curtis on them as well.
It's Buddy's idea. At that time, the French song had been out, you know, in all French. And he thought it'd be a good idea and might be a pop hit. Jolie Blanc. Jolie T, Jolie D, Jolie Cop, Marcy T, the Marcy, the big end of the shot.
Buddy had married a girl from New York, and Buddy felt like he could be closer to the business part of the music business if he was in the New York area. And he came to Jerry and I and said that that's what he wanted to do. And if we wanted to, you know, come on, let's all go together. Jerry and I chose not to.
And when he decided to break with Norman Petty, and J.I. and Joe B. decided to stay with Norman Petty, he come by and just brought a bass by and said, learn to play this. You got 2 weeks.
You know, he said, well, Waylon, you play bass. I think Waylon said, I never played bass in my life.
Yeah, well, what I did was memorize every song he'd ever recorded with him. And about after I'd been out on the road a couple of weeks, I realized that the bass was the first four strings of a guitar. It was amazing to me. And it almost ruined the whole thing.
Their dance party tour heads into the frigid American Midwest in January of 1959 with a young and eager Waylon Jennings backing up his mentor, Buddy Holly.
I like to describe him as an upper, because he was just happy all the time. And he really matched his music, if you know what I mean. Because he had a happy music and everything, had a lot of energy in it. And he taught me a lot of things in a real short period of time, you know, and about never compromising, you know, when it comes to your music. Do what you feel. It seemed like he was trying to tell me, you know, everything he could in a short time. Of course, he had no way of knowing what was going to happen, and I didn't either.
Buddy Holly was one of four people killed today when their single-engine plane crashed into a cornfield about 8 miles from the Clear Lake, Iowa airport. The plane, bound for Fargo, North Dakota, was carrying Holly to a concert in nearby Moorhead, Minnesota. Though Holly and pilot Roger Peterson have been identified as two of the passengers, there is some confusion as to the identities of the other two victims.
It took me a lot of years to get over it. You know, you feel guilty yourself, thinking you caused it, you know, some way. And you analyze that, and you watch his mother and dad, and the way that it affects them, you know. And I was just awful young, and it had a real effect on me for a long time. sudden, I just decided, well, I want to go to Arizona. I want to live there. And I packed up everything. Everybody never said anything to anybody and took off. And went to work at a place called Frankie's. And I think there were two people there the first night I was there.
In 1961, America might have been twisting the night away, but Waylon was now beginning a four-year stretch at JD's, a Phoenix hotspot.
It's a thing called paying your dues. But while you're paying your dues, you're learning your craft. You're learning your trade. You're learning what you're going to do.
He formed his backing group, the Whalers, and toiled long hours in front of an ever-growing legion of fans.
I played a little bit of every kind. I played a little rockabilly, a little rock and roll, and country. But the thing about it was that I'd learned the energy thing. The music was there. I mean, the energy was there in the music, you know.
The club was jam-packed, especially on weekends. It was packed six nights a week that we played. But it seated 1,500 people upstairs. And we had a huge dance floor in front of us. And on the weekends, we'd be into the third set before anybody there get up and dance.
When you're working that many nights, you know, and working that much, you get tired of singing the song the way the guy sung it, so you'll do it a different way, and you wind up doing it your way.
Bass player played 16th notes, and the rhythm player just kind of doubled up. And so it was a rolling sound, that rolling sound.
I was astounded, really. The whole place was packed, and Waylon was singing his songs, he was singing Beatles, he was singing Bob Dylan, whatever was popular, Elvis, and boy, like a blooming way. And then he had like himself and a couple other instruments, small group, big crowd, and it was wonderful.
In late 63, Waylon's old radio cohort, Don Bowman, begins to fly in from the West Coast for some marathon songwriting sessions.
We'd go in on a Saturday morning and stay till Monday. We'd write 18, 20 songs, have a little walling sack, cut the demos on walling sacks.
We wrote that just to satisfy you. I almost didn't even try to record that, but I didn't think it was any good at all.
But I wrote them on a plane ticket and wrote them around like this. Someone's going to get hurt before you're through when we cut the demo. Waylon's sitting there like this, and I'm turning the plane ticket like this so Waylon can read around it and sing. He's going, someone's going to get hurt before you.
That song has really lived through the ages, you might say. You know, me and Willie even did it. Someone's going to get hurt before you're through. I got to know Herb Alpert and Jerry Moss, who had A&M Records, and they just had The Lonely Bull, and there's a struggling new label, you know.
When I went to Herb Alpert and Jerry Moss, I said, this guy is going to be a star, a major star.
The sound on the tape was really intriguing. Really, a minor goosebump.
So they wanted me to come with him, and he wanted to play some tapes for him, so I did.
I thought it was time for that, you know, that big crossover country artist, you know, hit on both charts.
The problem with me recording with A&M is Herb Alpert heard me as Al Martino, I think, and I was leaning more toward Blacks and Scruggs.
The timing, I think, was a little off because in Waylon's part, he felt that would be a little bit too much of a transition for him, and he didn't want to lose, you know, the country folks.
He probably would have kept on until I got some kind of a record that got on the rock stations and ruined my whole life.
The A&M singles made little headway on the charts, and Waylon headed back to the friendly confines of JD's. Hollywood had taught him to be practical.
When you're starting out, don't be running to Nashville, and don't be running here and there and everywhere. Go somewhere, sit down, make some record. You know, play your music and make them notice you. When they come to you, then the doors are always open. But if you come to Nashville, the doors are never open.
And one time I was driving through Phoenix, and I heard Waylon's recording on the radio of Just to Satisfy You and Four Strong Winds. And I got a copy of it and took it back to Nashville to Chet Atkins.
And Bobby Bear said, there's a guy in Phoenix that he said, I shouldn't tell you this because he does the same type of material I do. I said, you should sign that Waylon Jennings.
He has got it. And he deserves, he actually deserves a real decent shot on a major record label.
I said, you want to record for RCA? And he said, yeah, he thought so.
Because, you know, Chet Atkins called him. That's God's right hand for his country music, you know.
walk in there, the most important thing in your life is to impress him. You know?
He had that guitar covered with leather, and he was wearing a lot of leather, and he was young and handsome, and I thought, I found me a star.
I told Chet, you know, that how magical he was with his group, so he brought some musicians with him.
It was a strange thing, because, you know, they didn't like that in those days at all. They didn't even like the sidemen to be on Music Row.
And, of course, Chet wasn't geared for recording with strange musicians, because he had his own pickers that he liked to use.
Scary, man. Chet Atkins was producing, Ray Stevens was playing vibes and piano, and Pig Robbins was playing piano, Jerry Reed on guitar. Yeah, I mean, I was just surrounded by all these legends, and I was scared to death.
Sting high notes, Waylon would always reach up in the air to get them. And when he'd be flat or something, I'd say, reach a little higher, Waylon.
I'm naturally nervous around it, but in the studio, it was really fun with him. I learned more from him than anybody I ever knew.
Waylon would soon have occasion to compare notes with another young RCA singer-songwriter.
I was working in a place called Riverside Ballroom, I think, and that probably was the first time that I met Waylon. We met, talked about his career and mine, how things were going. We were both from Texas, so we had a little, you know, a lot of things to talk about, a lot of things in common.
And I, of course, was working with JD's, and I told him that they'd been trying to get me to move to Nashville after I had my first single out here on RCA.
I asked him what he was making, where he was, and told him to stay where he was.
I was getting an apartment here, so I asked him to, he said, you know, just save money, move in with me, and we'll room together over in this Madison apartment. And the funny thing about it, both of us were on drugs, you know. I was doing pills and he was too. Yeah, I think we had a mutual respect for each other as artists. And when we got to know each other, we had so much in common. Our love for music and at that time our love for chemicals. And I heard about that and they'd asked me to audition for that. And I went and auditioned, but I thought I was terrible. I was the one they wanted, you know, so I went ahead and did it, you know, and I don't know how in the world I did it because I was out of it most of the time.
I'd have to make my mark in life with music. You know, anything can be said with a song. I've got things I'd like to say in my own way.
I'm alone.
That guy's a movie star. So what in the hell's he in there for? Never heard of that guy.
Born a co-starring Mary Fran of Bob Newhart fame, Nashville Rebel becomes a staple of B-movie drive-ins, but brings Waylon few acting offers from Hollywood. The title is somewhat prophetic. But for the time being, the country rebel is satisfied to be working in Nashville with country music's most established songwriter.
Yeah, I mean, I remember it was like, you know, it was one day I'd just written two or three songs, and I was putting them down there with a guitar in my little studio, and Waylon, you know, if he was in town, he'd come there and hang out, him and Don Bowman and a bunch of neat guys, and I'd written a song, put it down, it's called The Choking Kind.
I remember the first time I heard that, it was a demo that he had done just himself. And I flipped over that song. I loved that song, you know.
I always go to the sessions with him, and melodically, it's like my melody was pretty straight. And with this beautiful voice of his, he changed the melody. And I thought, I like that melody better. And I don't even know if I've ever told him that.
I only meant to love you.
Don't you know it, babe? That's as far as I remember. Back to the whistling. When you don't know the words, whistle.
I only meant to love you. Don't you know it, babe?
I might be stealing his memory now.
Why couldn't you be content with the love I gave?
And so on and so forth. But all I'm saying is that when I sang, when I talked to him,
melodically it wasn't, and he made the notes pretty. Mine was more like straight, and you know, he'd make them a little, sing a little better. And of course, he had a lot better voice than I did, so.
It's a frustrating period for Will. Despite some modest chart success, he seemed to be constrained by the system. The compromise of his current folk country style was just not cutting it.
I was just trying to make a record that would sell, that the disc jockeys would play, and I never thought about let's make a pop record or let's make a folk record. I didn't think too much in that direction.
It's scared. People around here get scared of these music people because they don't really try to ever invent anything. They try to take something that somebody else has invented and copy it. But if it goes for a period of time and nobody invents nothing, then there ain't nothing to copy. That's when Waylon hit town at a good time. Town needed Waylon bad when he hit here.
But for Waylon's part, he was becoming more and more disillusioned with the assembly line recording process that seemed to leave the artist out in the cold.
I wanted to be able to produce and record my own songs and arrange them and not be limited in what I did. And they thought if I got that freedom to do that, that there'd never be another need for a producer in this town.
Nashville at the time, the people who were in power, it was a very controlled environment. You either did it that way or didn't do it.
The same problems that existed in those days still exist today. Whatever you want to do, you got to fight for it.
Waylon was one of the few that really, really bucked the powers that be, I guess.
I think they thought I wanted something else, just power. Or that I was out to destroy something, and actually I was out to survive. I was on the road one time, almost 300 days one year. Didn't work that many days, but I was out there because we went through one tour, and me and Richie were talking about it, and we passed through Syracuse five times and never played it. But it wasn't like a tour. You're just out there all the time. All the time.
Yeah, I think some of these promoters will get a map of North America and just throw darts, and where's the dart? That's where you're going to go next.
Trying to get from Fort Myers, Florida to Michigan one night. It's crazy.
You're riding in the back of the bus. Now, how am I going to pay the band? I'm going to do these five honky-tonks on the way to Albuquerque.
You know, boy, that's not good. That's not good at all. And it'll get you, and it got me, and it got a lot of the rest of us. That is a dead-end street.
I guess it's in blue and green motel rooms. It's not very inspiring. There's nothing inspiring about the road.
Waylon's creativity suffered. The predictable rationalization of using pills to cope became dangerously convincing and served to strain his association with Chet.
My relationship was always great with Waylon when he was straight. You know, he loved me. He always told me he loved me when he was straight, but when he got drugged out a little, he didn't like me. He got paranoid toward me.
He loved him, respected him, but yet he couldn't quite communicate to Chet because he didn't quite know. All he knew is the records he was making were kind of sterile. They were kind of boring, and I mean, they weren't the excitement that he wanted. Chet hated pills so bad. He hated drugs, you know, so bad. And that may have been the reason he turned me over to someone else, because, you know, I mean, I was really into him, pretty strong man.
By 1970, Chet Atkins had moved on to administrative duties at RCA, and Waylon is handed over to a revolving door of staff producers.
I just decided to get out of it. I couldn't do it anymore. I couldn't handle it because I was killing myself. And I was smart enough to know that stress is what gets you.
You know, I would go in with these producers. We cut a record and come back and wouldn't recognize it. You know, somebody put a bunch of horns and stuff on it and had nothing to do with what I was doing.
Despite a string of top five hits, Waylon was at a crossroads. The road life, the pills, and the ongoing frustration with his career had finally caught up with him. Early 1972 found Waylon in a hospital bed, suffering from hepatitis and near bankruptcy.
I was close to quitting as I ever was, because, you know, I needed money to get through that time. And I asked RCA, you know, if they would let me have, you know, an advance on royalties. First they said yes, and then they came back and said they would only give me half of what they said they would begin with, only if I would sign you know, for another 5-year deal, you know. And that's when I thought, well, if that's the way it is, you know. And I said, no, forget it. I just won't, you know, I think I had another year on a contract. And I said, I just think I'll pass.
Actually, when he was down with hepatitis, I worked to be a brand new start for him. And that's when a lot of things opened up.
So Richie came to see me, and my drummer. And he said, let me tell you something, Hoss. He said, I can tell you're fixing to quit. He says, you don't want to do that. You can't do that. He says, let's try one more time. Just one more time. He says, there's another way of doing things, and they call it rock and roll.
Awesome, ornery, and mean marks the emergence of Waylon Jennings, the Outlaw, a bearded, long-haired figure who deliberately flaunts the traditional Nashville image.
We were back in the 70s, and everything was pretty traditional at that point. And it was either traditional or very pop. And Waylon just brought a different edge to it completely, just a whole different personality. That whole rock and roll background and that strong backbeat that kind of came out, his lead guitar kind of running through everything, and the whole attitude of his songwriting, I think just opened up an entire generation to country music that had not been exposed to it before.
Role manager Neil Russian is hired and brings his New York business style to bear on the Nashville executives. He renegotiates Waylon's recording contract, and Waylon soon has control over a musical career that has definitely taken a heavier turn.
Offbeat, little guitar work and stuff in there that he did mainly himself, and that's Waylon himself made the difference in the sound of his records.
There's a certain rhythm he has, and he goes, that's his base or his foundation. He goes on top of that certain rhythm. It seems to be in a lot of his songs, you know.
As soon as you hear it, it's a trademark, you know. That is Waylon Jennings, you know. That beat, the halftime, the waltz, that's Waylon.
You know what? That song and that album was the turning point for the whole industry here and the whole thing. It got away from what they'd call everybody doing records with a Nashville sound, you know. And it was really loose because some of those songs on that album didn't have the three pieces on them. Drums, bass, and my guitar, and me singing.
And they were a lot looser type recordings. Waylon started playing his own guitar, putting in that great Richie Albright foot drum, you know. Things, they weren't perfect records anymore, but they were great records.
Rid of the sequin suits and all the glitz and glitter and got down funky with it.
They recorded outside of RCA Studios. Honky Tonk Heroes marks the first album on which Waylon has complete artistic control. It has a clear sense of purpose and carries an honest emotional impact.
The biggest selling albums I had, but it showed such freedom and such, it was so loose. It was everything that had not been going on, you know. It showed that I was in charge, that I was in control of music, and it was me. It was my music and the way I did things.
And that's when he started really selling bunches of records. It's when he finally got it together to make his own kind of music, which to me didn't sound like anybody else's.
He just kind of took his recordings into his own hands and started renting his own studio and producing his own records. He was really the first recording artist ever to do that, you know. Maybe not many people know what a pioneer he was in terms of getting the actual production and recording procedures into the hands of the artist.
I went over to Tom Paul Glazer's studio and cut an album. And I said, this is all you got. They said, if we release that album that breaks your union contract with the engineers and RCA, between RCA and the engineers union. And I said, this is all you got.
The Dream in My Dream sessions begin in November of 1974 and are destined to bring Waylon his first gold album. The title track becomes one of Waylon's all-time favorite recordings.
I have seen in my life, you know, because I've been married more than most families. And you know, if you could come out of those things without being bitter, you know, and, because it ruins your life if you let it make you bitter. And the whole thing is like if you ever love somebody, you always will, so you might as well just try to put it in another place in your life and go on. And that song, that said so much like that, you know.
You could spend a lot of time listening to that record and get a real different sound of Waylon Jennings. And it was a real artistic record, was commercial. Not necessarily totally commercial, but it was a great moment in his career.
Law was on the prowl, and country music would never be the same.
The rock field, the pop field, all those other fields that have no limits. None. And here we sit here and put limits on ourselves where we, you know, well, we don't want to go too this far, too far this way. We don't want to go too far this way.
The boundaries were well and truly stretched in January of 1976 when Wanted the Outlaws is released, featuring contributions from Jesse Coulter, Tom Paul Glaser, and Willie Nelson. By the end of that same year, it becomes the first album in country and western record history to sell over 1 million copies. Notably, the LP features a remixed version of Good Hearted Woman, which Waylon sings as a duet with Willie Nelson. It's their first major collaboration, but was destined not to be their last.
I first got the idea of that song. I was reading an ad somewhere. I think I was in Vegas, and it was talking about Ike and Tina Turner show, the Ike and Tina Turner review. And it says, a good-hearted woman singing songs about good time and men. And I said, whoa, that's a great title. Then he said, I want to record it. I thought, well, wait a minute. And also, one time me and Willie was in the Best Western Hotel in Fort Worth playing poker.
I think he had most of that song written. We were in a poker game, and he said, hey, I'm writing a song. So I thought we laid out of a poker game for a few hands, and I think I gave him a line or two and wound up with half the song. So accidental. I had basically retired when I went back to Texas, and I was just going to keep a little small band, work some clubs. But then I noticed the crowds where I was playing, there was a lot more young people than I had noticed in the past few years. A lot of long-haired kids sneaking in the back, sitting away in the back somewhere, listening to the music.
So it wasn't too long after that, Willie was down in Austin, he called me and he says, you got to come down here and play this place. So I think I found something.
So I immediately decided, well, this was the future for country music, but here's the young people of the country, and they're liking country music, so these are the people we should be singing to.
I look out there, and all these little long-haired kids are out there. There ain't nobody, and no cowboy hats, and no cowboy suits out there. And I said, somebody go get that little red-headed son of a bitch. I said, he's got me in something, and so he called me back there, and I said, Willie, what have you got me into this time? First time I ever saw her. Of course, no, but thinking she's the cutest thing I'd ever seen. She was married at that time to Dwayne Eddy, and Dwayne came into town, and I happened to be in the studio working, and he came by to see me, and she was with him.
I knew I was a little reluctant, and had lived pretty sheltered, and he was quite a talker, and quite a fella.
This letter, which said, in essence, that you need me. You can't take care of yourself. That's what it says now as I look back, you know. And you need somebody to watch after you, you know, and I happen to be the one. I sat down, and we were doing a Hank Williams thing. I was doing the harmony on Storms Never Last, Hank Jr. record.
I'm thinking about, well, am I going to play Slide on this one, or maybe I'll play Dobro? I mean, that's what was on my mind. You know, here come the Doors crashing in.
Went on and on and on and on. I think my lawyer fees are $70,000 trying to get out of it. It feels good, you know. It raises you up a little bit. And then you start chasing feeling. And that's what I did for many years, because I kept doing more and more cocaine trying to get that first high that I got, but you never do. People say, you're killing yourself. You say, oh, it's my life. I'll do what I please. You know, it's not your business. It's my life. That's true. If you want to live out somewhere in a cave where you don't affect other people's lives, but you don't have a right to destroy their lives with what you're doing wrong.
I spent a lot of time in prayer and believing that he would be drug-free for years and years. And I knew it was coming.
The look I saw on her face, you know, I mean, the drawing, you know, from worry and just going through hell. Living with me, because I wasn't mean to her, but I was never home, you know, I was never there, and the only time she'd see me is when I come in to crash and sleep for days, and she didn't know when I would sleep, I'd ever wake up.
I remember asking him, dude, are you gonna, you know, go somewhere and get some help, and he said, Betty Ford didn't get me on that crap, and Betty Ford won't get me off of it. Now, it took some strength to do that.
Anybody can quit. Anybody. But they have to want to, and they have to make up their mind. And no doctor can make up your mind.
Soon after his recovery from drug addiction. Soon after that, a lot of people that had been helping him because he took this step, they were helped. They got off of it.
I was a pretty big rock and roller, so I mean, there's a lot of things I remember that I had a lot of fun at, and I'll never do it again.
He's a very complex person, which a lot of people don't realize. A lot of people see country music as being very simple, but it has a meaning.
Just because you're from somewhere in the middle of nowhere in Texas and you're a good old boy doesn't mean you're simple or simplistic. You can be very contradictory and very complex. I think he's a very complex guy, and I think that base of being complex gives him a great springboard into his wonderful work.
There's just some magnet about Waylon when he's on stage. When you see him in person performing these songs.
That's it. That's why he Waylon. Yeah. To me, I mean, I was looking out there and said, this guy is the Hank Williams of today.
Has a way of lasting. Good songs have a way of staying around. I don't think Waylon's music will ever be forgotten. Not by me.
Say, you know, leave for people. It's like there's always one more way to do things, and that's your way. And you have a right to try that at least once.
I thought to leave your bed for the street was as simple as saying goodbye. I couldn't see how blind a man can be, or how quick